that is born, King of the Jews, for we have seen his star in the east and have come to worship him. When Herod the king heard these things, he was troubled, and all Jerusalem with him. When he had gathered all the chief priests and scribes of the people together, he demanded of them where Christ should be born. They said unto him, in Bethlehem of Judea, for thus it is written by the prophet, and thou, Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, art not the least among the princes of Judah, for out of thee shall come a governor that shall rule my people Israel. Then Herod, when he had privately called the wise men, inquired of them diligently what time the star appeared. He sent them to Bethlehem and said, go and search diligently for the young child, and when ye have found him, bring me word again, that I may come and worship him also. When they had heard that the king, they departed, and lo, the star which they saw in the east went before them until it came and stood over where the young child was. When they saw the star, they rejoiced with exceeding great joy. And you may be seated this morning. It's Christmas time. It's not Wednesday, it's Thursday. I'm wondering how many it has caught unprepared. Everybody got the Christmas shopping done? I have. That's why I'm looking for it on Wednesday. Okay, but some of you that the season has come too quickly. Thursday is too soon. It comes on you unprepared. But don't you just love Christmas? At least most people should. I do read in the media and statistics, though, that Christmas is a sad time a year for a lot of people, especially the poor and those that cannot afford to give gifts. It's a time when depression sets in and there are many suicides this time of year. I would like to spread the Christmas cheer and that Jesus is alive and well, and you don't have to be sad this Christmas. All right? Now, you hear people talk these days, there's just so much to do, and the hustle and the bustle and the rush, it seems like the joy that should accompany Christmas is not there. Well, tell me at least one person that hates to get gifts. That changes the story, doesn't it? Now, buying gifts to give, that's a different story, because you need money to do that, and sometimes if there's not enough to go around as it is, then you add the extra burden of Christmas on top of that. It's no wonder that the drama of Christmas drives some people crazy. I, over the years, have learned the experience that it's more blessed to give than it is to receive. See, sometimes people give to get. That's not what it's all about, is it? Christmas is a time for giving, period. All right? Now, having said that, I would also like to give you some advice as your pastor. I don't believe that Christmas time is a time that you should go in debt. Now, there's a lot of people that do. And if you're having a struggle to make ends meet at the end of the month, add Christmas to that, well, that just puts a lot of pressure on. We need to learn some disciplines and live within our incomes. Because I also read by statistics that disputes over finances is the number one wrecker of marriages. So hopefully that don't happen at Christmas time. My wife and I have learned how to do some things over the years. Now, our financial situation has changed, and we can't afford to give good gifts, and I thank the Lord for that. But we don't wait until December 1st to start buying Christmas presents. We start buying Christmas presents on December 26th. Yeah, a lot of deals for the next year, and you can afford to give value gifts that you won't find in December. Okay, and so, and then shop all year long, and it's not so stressful come December. Well, that's just something for nothing, okay? It's Christmas time. There's more than just finances that we find pressure on at Christmas time. In ministry, and I claim to be in ministry, there's another special stress that's put upon us at Christmas time. Say, what's that? To find something new to preach at Christmas. There's only a few scriptures, Matthew 1, Luke 2, and John 1, from which you can draw the Christmas story or tell the story. Well, so it's basically the same content from year to year. So, and I like what Solomon said in the book of Ecclesiastes 3:1. He says, there's nothing new under the sun. So even what I want to minister to you this morning may not be new. It may be a new take on it, okay? So I trust that the Christmas story never gets old or boring. I'm thankful that Jesus came in flesh to die so that I could live. And that's the essence of why Jesus came to Bethlehem's manger as a babe. So I've got two dilemmas. Not enough money to go around. Something new to preach. Well, let's try this morning. I'm going to talk about two kings and I. All right, two kings. We read to you in the text this morning from Matthew's Gospel, chapter 2, and in verses 1 and 2, it lists both kings there. Jesus, who claimed to be king of the Jews, and Herod, who claimed to be king of the Jews. Well, both really can't be king of the Jews at the same time, or one must be submissive to the other, or there's going to be war. Right? Well, no family or no organization could flow along successfully and smoothly with two heads. There's only one that's really supremely powerful. Well, we find in my lesson here this morning there were two kings, and one tried to kill and destroy Christmas, and the other made Christmas. Let's talk about the one that tried to destroy Christmas first. That, according to Matthew 2, verse 1 and 2, was Herod. King Herod was not happy about Christmas. Here goes the story. He heard that there was one who was born king of the Jews. He thought, I hold the title as king of the Jews, but I certainly wasn't born a king. I got this position through subtlety, some cruelty, some hatred. I was just a tyrant to actually get the title of king. So to Herod, there's only one king, and that was himself. And he had determined, and there's not going to be another. I'm going to do everything possible to eliminate my competition. So Herod, who holds the title of king of the Jews, he was born into a political and well-connected family. And he was destined to be king, and at 25 years of age, he became the king. And he assumed the top position of power in Galilee, that of their governor. So the Roman government was empowering Herod to actually control the Jews who lived in that area. King of the Jews. It was a title that the Jews themselves hated because Herod was anything but religious. Actually, Herod was quite a brutal villain. And I want to give to you this morning four obsessive characteristics that Herod had. Number one, Herod, who held the title as king of the Jews, he had a preoccupation and an obsession with power. Now, one could easily say he was addicted to power, or he was intoxicated with power, a very dangerous man. And if you look into your Bible and study the scriptures, oftentimes power or the abuse of power are ways to sin. But power is the ability to control the resources and to secure things to oneself for one's own purposes. And Herod cared for nobody else except himself. His life and his use and his misuse of power can be summed up in just three words. He was capable, he was crafty, and he was cruel. As far as him being capable, no sooner had he come to the throne and had that title of king of the Jews, he wiped out all of his competition and anyone who would be terrorizing the country. And he used subtle and diplomatic tactics to bring peace accords to those in surrounding countries. So in addition to him being very capable in the use of his power, he was also very crafty, exercising his power, arranging a lot of his relationships so that they would be conduits or channels or conductors for more power. Power was an obsession to Herod, and he could not seem to get enough of power. He was very capable of getting it. He was very crafty to bring it about, and his craftiness knew no barriers. And he had a very morbid trust and distrust for anyone who might be a threat to his kingdom. So that made him a very cruel man. Cruel, oh yes. He held the reins of King of the Jews very tightly, and he brutally removed anyone that was a threat to him. Now, not that the ones I'm going to list here in a moment were any threat to him, but he was just paranoid, okay? He did kill his brother-in-law. He killed his mother-in-law. He killed two of his sons, and he even killed his wife. He murdered out of spite, and he killed to stay in power. Human life meant nothing to Herod. It would seem that the intensity of Herod's cruelty grew in direct proportion with the amount of power that he possessed. To put that another way, the more power that he gained, the crueler he became. Herod was preoccupied and obsessed with power. Not only was he preoccupied and obsessed with power, he was preoccupied with possessions. Herod wanted it all. And he wanted everything that the Roman Caesar had. History tells us that Herod built 7 palaces, and they were very elaborate. Along with the 7 palaces, 7 theaters. And again, that would seat very many that would want to come to public occasions. And here's something is interesting. He even constructed a new temple for the Jews. I can't imagine anybody building something for somebody they hated. That just doesn't make sense. But he did it because he was crafty and he was cruel. He sought occasion and advantage. Okay, so I don't like the Jews. They're going to be under my thumb. I'll build them a temple as long as they honor me as King of the Jews. Thirdly, Herod was preoccupied with prestige. He loved to make an impression upon others, especially those in other countries who would be called king or governor up in high circles of society. He was known to build entire cities with state-of-the-art architecture and all the amenities that you could have within a city. And he had named these cities after his superiors. Herod was a smooth talker, and he seemed to have special ability to influence even those who would be his opposition. Several of his marriages, I think it's enough to be married to one woman. Herod had several. And his marriages were politically arranged to give him some prestige and some more political power. He married the daughter of one of his leading rivals in order to gain prestige and power over that people. So he was preoccupied and he was obsessed with power. He was obsessed with possessions. He was obsessed with prestige. And he was also preoccupied and obsessed with paranoia. And rightfully so. Someone that gets power the wrong way and possessions to no end and prestige surely would have to watch his back at all times. He is very paranoid. As a matter of fact, his own dad was a king, and another king had killed Herod's own dad. He thought, man, if my dad can't survive, I better certainly watch my back. And then he's got all this glamoring and clamoring for position and power and possessions and prestige. It's no wonder he's paranoid. Herod couldn't trust anyone. And by the way, that's a plague quite befitting for those that cannot be trusted. Herod was beset with paranoia. He went to great lengths to make sure that he was safe and secure. He commissioned thousands of slaves to build him emergency centers and fortresses that were heavily armed and well provided for. And then he established a network of spies throughout his kingdom. Any suspicious plot at all to come against his leadership was immediately sniffed out and eliminated. He even drowned some of his opposition in the Jordan River. Herod's rule was one of tyranny, but where did it get him? In the final months of Herod's life, he was slowly dying of a dreaded disease. His body racked with convulsions and his breath foul and his skin covered with open sores and, on top of it all, losing his mind. But he was still the king. That's king number one, the one that tried to destroy Christmas. Let me talk to you about king number two, the one who made Christmas. Of course, you and I know that is King Jesus today. Word had come to Herod that he's got some visitors from the east. These strangers have a strange question for Herod. And here it was. He said, "Where is he that is born king of the Jews?" Herod's mind is spinning again. I wasn't born king of the Jews, but I'm the only king of the Jews, and I'm going to be the only king of the Jews. These wise men said, "We saw his star in the east, and we have come to worship him." And Herod had fought and killed and destroyed to maintain the position of king of the Jews, and he was wondering what these strangers were talking about, one that was born king of the Jews. Why didn't the spies that I sent throughout my country to watch my back tell me about one that was born king of the Jews? Herod had just come head to head with another king, actually the one and only real king of the Jews. You and I know him as Messiah or Jesus Christ. The thing that Herod had greatly feared has come upon him. There is another king. He does have competition, and there does exist a threat to his kingship. This news struck Herod right to the core of his soul. Somehow, he must again put into action his power and his possessions and his prestige through all the paranoia and eliminate this one that is so-called born king of the Jews. Somehow there was a weakness in the fortresses that he had fortified. There was a king that was born. So all of Herod's capabilities and all of his craftiness and all of his cruelty was outwitted. How is it even possible that there could be a threat to his throne? Herod, in his mind, said, "I got one more thing to do before I'm dethroned or before I die, and that's to get rid of the one who was born king of the Jews." And he sets out to do so. We know him to be a smooth talker and a crafty, cunning man. So he asked these wise men, "What time did you say that the star appeared and that you're following?" And he logs that in his mind. He said, "Now, I want you to go and search diligently for this one born king of the Jews. And when you find him, bring me word again, because I want to go and," quote unquote, "worship him too." Yeah, right. He had no intentions of worshiping the one and only king of the Jews. He was wanting to eliminate his competition. So the wise men, they take their journey, and still trying to find the child, and traveled over some 800 miles. But they came to Bethlehem's manger, and there they find the child there in swaddling clothes in the manger. And they worshiped him. They presented unto him gifts. And little did they know that this little baby boy was more than just what people said was Joseph's son or a poor carpenter's boy's son. What they were beholding there was the Son of God, What they were looking at was the real King of the Jews. What they were looking at was the Savior of the world. Herod's cunningly devised plan to worship was outwitted by the sovereign God, because this sovereign God could talk to the wise men and instruct them to go home a different way. Because Herod's motives were not pure. He did not want to worship. He wanted to kill. Herod finally comes to the realization, I've been mocked. The wise men are not returning. They made a fool out of me. And that star appeared at such and such a time. I'm going to go back to that time and order that all the children born from that time on be murdered. He's so cunning. He's so crafty. And he's so cruel with the exercise of his power. He's got to eliminate his competition. Well, we know the end of the story. What's that? Herod couldn't kill Jesus. Aren't you glad of that today? Herod could not kill Jesus. So, let's take a quick review here and compare. This time I'm going to compare by contrast both kings. And they chose such opposite paths. If we look at power, we already told you that Herod, with all of his power, was a tyrant. And he came to ruin, to destroy, and to kill. Jesus used his power to serve and to save. Wow. When it comes to wealth versus poverty, Herod killed and destroyed to gain all the possessions that he had. And to him, he possessed the then known world. Little did he know that Jesus was the creator of the world, and yet he gave it all. That's something. What about pain? Herod, in all of his cruelty, he knew how to inflict pain on others, and it was ironic that in the last days of his life, he also suffered disease with excruciating pain. I wonder if the pain that he experienced was in any way proportionate to the pain that he inflicted on others. But Jesus also experienced pain. He was a man that was acquainted with grief and with suffering and sorrow. If you take into the account of Garden of Gethsemane and the cross of Calvary, Jesus knew what it was to experience suffering and pain. And even in their deaths, such opposite paths and cruel differences. Herod could not save himself. Jesus could have saved himself and chose not to. What about their lifetime? In their lifetime, Herod, he wielded the power of hatred and self-protection, and he formed armies and built fortresses and killed at will, all for his own selfish gain. But Jesus, in his lifetime, suffered willingly, suffered the abuse of religious leaders, suffered abuse by the willingly ignorant and the hard-hearted, and he was rejected by many. There were constant threats to Jesus' life, and he was betrayed by many friends. He suffered the beatings of his enemies, and then there was his death on the cross. Jesus did it for one reason and one reason only, and that was to demonstrate his power of love for mankind, to reach out and to save their soul. That's the story of two kings, one that tried to destroy Christmas and the other that made Christmas. But what about me? How does these two affect me? Or how does it affect you and I? Well, the first lesson today, it doesn't matter how well fortified and safe and secure you may feel that your own defenses may be, especially when it comes to the question, what are you going to do with Jesus? You think, well, I don't go to church, or I wouldn't want to go to church, or don't call me a Christian. When I ask you this morning, what are you going to do with Jesus? And you have all kind of reason and hide behind of all kinds of excuses, defenses of all kind. But I'm telling you something this morning. You cannot outsmart a sovereign God. He always wins. You might as well submit to the Lord now as bow a knee later. For there is coming a day when every knee shall bow, and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. Jesus is all powerful. He owns all possessions. He doesn't need any prestige because he is God. And there's coming a day when the whole of creation will know and recognize him as God and worship him as God. Jesus doesn't have to be paranoid. That's not one of his attributes. He's quite secure in who he is. Amen. He submitted all that on Calvary in your stead. Now I can live free from sin and the dominion of Satan because Jesus gave his life for me. Now, that's how Jesus affected me. I'm coming to a close here. What about Herod? Sometimes there's a battle in our own bodies or in our own minds between these two kings. Say, why? There's a little bit of Herod in all of us. Say, how so? Well, we think we're capable. Sometimes we can be quite crafty and a little bit cruel in the way we go about gaining power and possessions and prestige. Some are even paranoid by having got it through wrong means. But what about Jesus? He's safe in the arms of a loving mother. Wow. You've got Jesus, you got Herod, both moving very fastly from total different directions. Herod represents the popular perspective on power. Get it, keep it, use it. Jesus has a different perspective on power. And yet his philosophy was radical enough to change the world. He used his power to save those who were lost. No wonder these two kings clashed. They both possessed immense power, but the way that they chose to manifest it was very different. One was a tyrant, the other was a servant. One was consumed with self-interest, the other focused on pleasing God and serving others. One manipulated and slandered and deceived and coerced, the other healed, he touched, he taught, and he loved. However, both of them agree on one thing. There's nothing that shed blood can't cure. Wow. Now we know that Herod, he shed the blood of his rivals. Jesus shed his own blood. Quite a difference there. Quite a difference, isn't there? Amen. So this morning, as we bring this to a close, how important is power and control to you? How important is possessions to you? How important is prestige to you? And have you gone about gaining these? And has it made you paranoid? I'm telling you of a Savior this morning that can reach down and take care of all of these. There's a scripture in Romans chapter 12 and verse 1 that I want to leave with you today. It tells us to present our bodies a living sacrifice. I beseech you, therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that ye present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. Now, if you will, submit to the Lord. You shouldn't have a problem with power. You shouldn't have a problem with possessions. You shouldn't have a problem with prestige. And certainly shouldn't have a problem with paranoia. You say, why? Because if you submit your life to Jesus, all those other things are put in his proper perspective. So there's two kings, and I or you. Amen. If God be for us, who can be against us? Amen. Would you stand this morning? A little different slant on the Christmas story. Amen. Christ died for your salvation of mine. Sister Irma, if you come back to the piano again. Praise God. We got 10 minutes before the meal is ready downstairs. I moved fast.